Amen, church, and welcome. Whether you're joining us online or here in the room, welcome this morning. You know, when I was growing up in church, we used to say, God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. And I'm so thankful for those words that have carried with me, because it doesn't matter what we come here in the room or what we carry with us at home, God is here with us today. Would you stand with us as we celebrate our great and glorious God today?
All right, good morning, everybody. It is good to see you. Let's just all worship together, all right? I believe that the future is brighter. I believe in His promise for me. I believe that He's working and He's not done. The best is yet to come. I know He makes the anxious courageous. I know He makes the doubters believe. I know He won't stop working because He's not done. The best is yet to come.
Hope is that You are alive and on the throne. And even when we don't feel that truth, God, we are going to choose to worship You. Not because it makes us feel better, but because it's what You deserve, God. I choose to worship and I choose to bow. Though there's pain in the offering, I lay it down. Here in the conflict, when doubt surrounds, though my soul is unraveling, I choose You now. And I will praise You through the fire, through the storm, and through the flood. There is nothing that could ever steal my soul. In the valley, You are worthy. You are good when life is not. You will always and forever be my soul. And I have built my altar right here and now. In the midst of the darkest night, it won't burn out. For you are perfect, no matter what. In the joy or the suffering, I'll sing it loud. And I will praise you through the fire, through the storm and through the flood. There is nothing that could ever steal my song. In the valley, you are worthy. You are good when life is not. You will always and forever be my song. When the enemy says I'm done, I'll lift my praises. When my world comes crashing down, I'll lift my praises high. Till the darkness turns to dawn, I'll lift my praises. I choose to worship, I choose you now. When the enemy says I'm done, I'll lift my praises. When my world comes crashing down, I'll lift my praises high. Till the darkness turns to dawn, I'll lift my praises. I choose to worship, I choose you now. And I choose to worship, I choose you now. And I will praise you through the fire, through the storm.
Keep continuing to choose to worship you, no matter how strong that night seems, no matter how long it seems. We're gonna choose to worship you because you deserve it, God. You are our only hope. We know that you're on that throne, and that's why we sing Jesus. The days may be darkest, your light is greater. You light our way, God, you light our way. When evil is rising, you're rising higher, with power to save, with power to save. You keep hope alive, you keep hope alive. From the beginning to end, your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive. Well, death had a stronghold, but your love was stronger. Rose from the grave, rose up from the rising.
keep hope alive, because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive. Jesus, it's true, you are alive. It's the reason we're here. It's the reason why we're singing. It's the reason why we're here to listen to the truth about what you do for us. God, you are a living, breathing God who is still seated on the throne, and that's why we sing to you. And I pray that as we hear this next message, that we do hear something new, that something that didn't make sense before would make sense now, that we would let go of maybe what's not true and we hang on to that truth. And God, I know that no matter how dark our days are, that you will be brighter. You will still be there on that throne, and we hang on to that hope with everything we have. And God, I pray that we would hear something new again. And we pray this in your Son's name. Amen. You may be seated.
My name is Tiffany Daniel. I'm the Children and Family Ministry Director here at Renaissance, and I'm so excited to share some really great news with you this morning. The staff and volunteers here at REN are ready to start offering some children's programming beginning in September. That's right. If you're ready for your kids to get back to a routine here at church with learning at their level, a time for worship, scripture discussion, and memorization, and just having an opportunity for them to hang out with their peers, then we are ready for them. Kids classes are opening on September 13th at the 9 a.m. service only. We will offer nursery, toddler, preschool, and some early elementary classes. Because we will be focused on teaching and engaging with the kids at the 9 a.m. service, we will not be offering kids activities in the main room at 9 a.m. Check-in for the kids will be available at 8:50, just 10 minutes prior to the service starting. You will not check in your nursery, toddler, or preschool students like you have in the past, as that space is still under construction. But we will be utilizing our old main room gathering space and the surrounding classrooms. This allows us to spread out and have both a small group area and a place for large group worship, just like we have up here in the main room. However, if you have enjoyed sitting together as a family, then we encourage you to continue attending to the 11 a.m. service, as we will be back up here greeting your kids, having the packets available, and working to make all the kids feel comfortable and engaged during that service. That's it for now. Just know that we have missed your kids, and we are looking forward to caring for them, engaging with them, and to continue to teach them the truth and love of Jesus. If you have any questions about our reopening of the kids' space or other questions about children or youth here at REN, please reach out to me or any of our staff after the service, or email us at info@rendecator.org.
Hey everyone, good morning, good morning. I'm so glad you've chosen to spend your Sunday with us. Whether you are online or live here in the room, welcome. I am solo today, so I don't have anybody with me, so feel sorry for me as I try to get through all the announcements. If you are new here, we would love to meet you. Pastor Jeff and I will be outside once the overhead door goes up to your left, and we'd love to say hello and send you home with something. And we're just so excited that people are getting out and coming back, and so welcome. Next Sunday, there is a whole lot of things happening next Sunday as we start activating our small groups and stuff like that. Our prayer team will meet here in the main room, and if you're interested in prayer, not only in the main service, but throughout the week, someone just asked me about praying throughout the week. This is the place or the team that you maybe should engage with and just get some more information. So next Sunday for that, next Sunday night, our worship team team is starting their small group. So again, if you're interested in being involved in worship either now or down the road, I encourage you to look into this small group. It will happen here in our main room Sunday nights at 4 o'clock. I know you guys all just saw the return to kids programming. We're so excited about that. That had most of the information you need. So I won't go into too much detail, but just know our kids workers, they're called to work with kids. Their heart's desire is to teach young kids about Jesus. And in this transition, they have so missed, you know, just loving on your kids, educating your kids. And so they're excited about getting this program up and going. It's happening at 9 o'clock, and we hope you guys will take advantage of that. The other thing I wanted to share with you is lots of you have asked from time to time when we're going to get back to live preaching. And I appreciate having Jeff or Josh or somebody else up here is probably a little bit more engaging than when they're on video. But just know that, you know, I say Pastor Jeff, I teasingly say that, you know, he has ADD and he can't sit in a room with a bunch of kids because he'd be distracted. But really, we were trying to prepare and plan in case one of us on staff got infected or had to, you know, just sit alone and stay isolated, that we still had a plan and a program to continue on. We didn't have to shut down. But that being said, we're going to try to get back to live worship or live teaching next Sunday. So we're excited for that. So just pray all of us stay healthy and that we'll be able to continue on. Giving. Yeah, see, I'm trying to click through this stuff. Giving, thank you guys. You know, it's been a challenge. It's been a challenge probably for you and your own finances and work and layoffs and all that kind of thing. It's been a challenge here at the church as well, but God is faithful, and we would just want to thank you for being honoring to Him, giving not only in your worship time, but in sacrificing of your finances, and just thank you. So we're blessed to have you be here and be a part of what we're doing. And so I would like to pray just that God just continue to bless the ministries that are happening here in the Decatur area. Thank you, Father God, that you know the plan and the purpose for all, not only our church, but all the churches in the area, Father God. And I just thank you that you continue to bless us here at Renaissance. You continue to bless the people that so faithfully give, that are honoring to you in their finances, Father God. I pray that you continue to strengthen our faith and our faith walk as we go through these challenging times. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You can give throughout the building, you can give online, but we have Pastor Josh up next for you this week, and we look forward to seeing you back again next week. Thanks, guys.
Renaissance family, it's so good to be with you, whether you're here in the room or joining us online. Listen, today we're excited. We're starting a new series. It's Coffee Mug Theology, and maybe you have a mug similar to this, and this one, Psalm 46:10, be still and know. Or maybe you have a favorite magnet or a plaque on your wall, and it just kind of has a verse or part of a verse, and we're kind of looking at some of those because there's that could be helpful. It can remind you and be a thing that of encouragement. Or we have the calendars, you know, with the verse of the day, but it can also if we're pulling that scripture out of the context of the chapter and verse and book that it's in, it really can be a danger if we begin to kind of run down a road that it was never intended for. And so we are actually looking at some of those verses. Not necessarily all of them are going to be, you know, kind of the out of context dangers, but we just want to, you know, look at some of those things. The one that we're looking at today is Psalm 37:4, is delight yourself in the Lord and He will give you the desires of your heart. Now, when I was growing up in the church I was a part of, I love the church that I grew up in. I really do. But even worship leaders can fall kind of into this trap of taking scriptures kind of out of context and using them because they sound good. So, you know, you'd get that boom chuck going, a boom on the drum set, and there was this song that it was they run on the cities, they rush on the walls, for great is the army that carries out His word. Right, the Lord utters His voice before His army. And then blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. And I was a trumpet player, right? So I actually got to be part of the worship team. And when they would do this song, they'd ask me to come and get to this part. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Here it is. Bump, bump. That was my big moment, right? Sound the alarm. Well, that is actually from Joel. Prophet Joel, the book of Joel. And it's the army of the Lord is really his judgment that he's bringing. And then the army is locusts that are running on the cities and rushing on the walls. And they're carrying out God's word. And so we're singing in church, right? We got the boom chuck on the drum set, and we're just going at, and it's completely out of context. You know, again, I love the church I grew up in, and there was a lot of good memories there. But that was one where, oh, Joel, prophet Joel, bringing destruction on Israel. So those are some of the dangers. But we're looking today at Psalm 37:4. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. And just at first glance, we can call like, hey, wait a minute, red flag. Like we know, right? The desires of my heart, God's just going to give them to me if I delight myself in Him. What does that even mean? All right, so let's look at that first part. The command of that verse is delight yourself in the Lord. We don't really use delight a lot, right? What does delight yourself in the Lord mean? And when you look it up in Webster's, it's just great pleasure. To delight means great pleasure, and it would be joy, but joy is really kind of not the full extent. It's like joy overflowing, right? It's peace, but it's not peace. It's like this peace that you've never had before. And so it's fully devoted. You could say it like this: love the Lord your God, right, with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. You're all in, but it's not a chore. Right? It's not a burden. It's a joy, or it's a, to use the word to describe the word, a delight, right? It's delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your hearts. That second part, that's the promise. He will give you the desires of your heart. So what does that look like? Well, I think when we delight ourselves in the Lord, when we give ourselves completely over to God, when we're all in, when we're loving God with all our heart, all our soul, right, all our mind and all our strength, our desires change, right? It's no longer really our desires. And God actually gives us some desires, and He gives us dreams, right? And He gives us these promises. But even then, it doesn't always play out the way, in fact, I'll just go ahead and say it. I'm going to step out on a limb. It never plays out the way you think it will. It's never your plan. It's never your way. And God says His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And somehow, some way, He gets glory in the end, and it's for our good and it's better, but it's never our plan. Now, I have some pretty good plans. I don't know about you, but I have some pretty good thoughts. I have some pretty good ideas that I often share with God. And I'm sure he gets a little chuckle out of it. But His ways are higher than our ways. In fact, if you go down in Psalm 37, it says that the steps of a man are established by the Lord. Another version, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, right? When he delights in his way. That's Psalm 37, starting in verse 23. When he delights in his way. And even when he falls, he will not be utterly cast down or cast headlong, because the Lord upholds him with his hand. And I just see this picture of me walking with one of my children. I have six of them, so I could just pick one, right? And I'm walking, and I'm setting the steps, right? I'm ordering the steps. I'm establishing the steps. They're ordered by me, and I'm holding their hand. So even if they trip, right? Even if they were to fall, they're not going to completely fall. They're not going to be utterly cast. They're going to be cast headlong. Why? Because I'm upholding them with my hand. And you see that picture of, especially toddlers, right? When they're walking along, and their feet are going all crazy, and there's the dad, right, or the mom, and they're walking, and they're not concerned. They have a hold of their hand, and though their toddler's legs might be going this, that way, and the other, they're not completely falling over because they're being upheld by their father. So David is writing this psalm in his old age, and verse 25, it says, I was young, but now I'm old. So this Psalm 37 is just him recounting some Proverbs in his life. So in fact, they really can each stand on their own. So Psalm 37:4 stands on its own. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. But again, like we said, it doesn't always look like the path that we would take. Let's look at probably one of the most hope-filled, one of the most optimistic characters in all of the Bible. All right, no matter what would happen, he's full of hope. No matter what would happen, he's got this optimism, right, that I desire. All right, so let's go to Genesis chapter 37. And the Judeo-Christian God is often referred to, especially with our Jewish friends, right? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? So God first comes to Abraham, and he picks him out of everybody and says, this is going to be, I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to make you a great people. So Abraham has a son named Isaac. Isaac has a son named Jacob. Now, Jacob is the one who wrestles with God, and God changes his name to Israel. So we have Israel. The nation of Israel is being born, right? So Jacob has 12 sons, and those are the 12 tribes or 12 people groups of Israel. One of those sons is named Joseph. Now, Joseph was the son of Jacob's favorite wife. Now, there's a whole backstory on why he has more than one wife, and please, you're welcome to read it. It's a pretty cool narrative, but it also shows us why we only should have one wife. But so he has this son by his favorite wife, Joseph, and he's younger than all the other sons because Rachel, Jacob's favorite wife, wasn't able to have sons until later on. And so they have the favorite son, Joseph, and he is hated by his brothers because so much favoritism is shown him. And at 17 years old, he's given this coat, this robe, right? One version says of many colors. Another one says it's a long robe with sleeves. And the only other time that's used in the Old Testament is to denote a royal robe, right? So he's really given him this robe that said, you're going to be the leader of the family. So these brothers really have a hard time with their youngest, at the time, brother Joseph. All right, they have a hard time dealing with him. In fact, there was a time that is recorded where he's a tattletale, comes back to the dad, said, "Hey, you saw my brothers, that you know what they were doing," and so the Bible says they can't even speak peaceably to him anymore. There's that much hatred, that much vitriol towards him. So what does this 17-year-old brother do? God gives him this dream, and the first thing he does is run to his brothers and tell them this dream. Hey, I had this dream, right? All of you are going to bow down to me. You know, it's from God. Isn't that awesome? Well, his brothers don't think it's awesome, right? They were already not speaking peaceably to him. They already hated him, and now they hate him even more. Then he has a second dream, the same thing. His brothers and now his mother and father bowing down to him. And even his dad's like rebukes him, but his dad is one who, that's his favorite. So he takes it and holds it in his heart. So there's this hatred towards this brother. The dad sends the brothers with their shepherds, and he sends them to pasture the sheep in Shechem. Now, if you remember anything about Shechem, this was a bad place for those brothers to go because they had killed a lot of people there. And people in Shechem didn't like these brothers. And so they decide, well, we're going to go 14, 15 miles further north. Well, Jacob, Israel, didn't know that. So he sends Joseph, his son, to Shechem to check on his brothers. So Joseph gets to Shechem, and he's kind of wandering around in the field. He happens to run into a stranger that says, oh, yeah, I heard your brothers talking that they were going to go to Dothan. So Joseph makes the trek, 14, 15-mile trek to Dothan. And as he's coming, they see the robe, right? They know who that is. All right, here comes the master of dreams. He's a ways off. Here comes the dreamer. And they say, we're going to kill him. We're going to end this, right? We're this far away. Dad's not going to know about it. We're going to kill him. We're going to say he was attacked by a wild animal. And the oldest brother is like, you know what? Maybe the way I can get back in my dad's good graces is saving him. So hey guys, he tells his brothers, let's put him in a pit. Let's not kill him. Let's put him in a dry cistern. So they do that. And while that oldest brother, Reuben, was gone, they see this caravan of Ishmaelites and they decide to sell him to the Ishmaelites. Like, we can get some money. We don't have to kill him. The blood's not going to be on our hands. It's a perfect scenario, right? So they take his robe, his royal robe, and they dip it in blood. They take it back to the dad. They've sold him now to the Ishmaelites. And his dad, Jacob, Israel, thinks he's dead. So here is Joseph. He's in the pit. Now he's sold into slavery. And we don't get anything recorded that he's a complainer. We don't get anything recorded that he's angry, but we know that he's human. So he can't be excited about it, right? He can't be extremely exuberant. But what we do see is the Ishmaelites take him to Egypt and he's sold to Potiphar, which is one of Pharaoh's officers. And he's working now a slave in Potiphar's house. And everything this guy touches does well. And as we read this narrative, we can say that, man, this Joseph was still delighting in God, even in the midst of the pit and slavery, and now working in this Potiphar's house as a slave. Because everything he touches, he has the favor of God on him. So he's working, and Potiphar's wife comes to him, and she says, lie with me, right? Joseph's a pretty good-looking dude. And she says, lie with me. And he says, no. Well, she propositions him a second time, and this time she grabs hold of his clothes when she propositions him, and he runs away, and she keeps his clothes. So he's buck naked, right? He's running away, and she accuses him and has his clothes as proof, so now he gets thrown into prison. So here's a guy, thrown into a pit, sold into slavery, a slave in a house. But Potiphar, the favor of God had been on him in such a way that he was, the only thing Potiphar had to worry about was the Bible says, the bread that he would eat. Joseph was over everything in the house, and now he finds himself in prison. Well, the leader of the prison found out the same thing. God is all over this guy. Everything he touches prospers. So he sets him up over all the prisoners, over everything that the prison would be about. Joseph's in charge. So Joseph finds himself still hopeful, still optimistic. Everything he's touching is turning to proverbial gold, right? We find him delighting himself in God, even in the midst of the pit, even in the midst of being a slave, even in the midst of being a prisoner. All right, well, one day, Pharaoh sends two of his officials, because there's one of them is treasonous, right? So he sends them both to prison. Joseph's there. He's taking care of these guys, and one morning, he sees that they're, man, what's going on with you guys? Why are you so sad? And they're like, we both had dreams, and there's no one to interpret him. And he's like, well, isn't God the interpreter of dreams? And so that's why we can pull from this thing that Joseph still had this relationship with God. Joseph was still delighting in the Lord. Joseph was still trusting in the eternal. He said, isn't God the one who interprets dreams? And so the cupbearer, the one who would taste the food and the wine so Pharaoh wouldn't be poisoned, and the baker were there in prison, and they both had dreams, and they tell these dreams to Joseph. Well, the cupbearer goes first. He tells him his dream, and Joseph says, "Oh, well, you're going to be restored. In 3 days you're going to be serving wine to Pharaoh again." So the baker's like, "Oh, okay, bet. Let me tell you my dream." So he tells him his dream, and Joseph says, "Oh, yeah, you're going to die. Crows are going to eat your eyes. You're going to be hung up to die, and yeah, it's not going to go well for you." Well, exactly what Joseph said happened. But he tells the cupbearer, remember me. When you go back to Pharaoh, remember me. And he goes back to Pharaoh and totally doesn't remember Joseph. So here's Joseph now, right? He's been betrayed. He's been thrown in a pit. He's been a slave. He's been now a prisoner. And now he's forgotten, right? All these things. And yet he's still hopeful. He's still optimistic. He's still, God is all over him and everything he touches. Right, a couple years go by and Pharaoh has a dream and nobody, not his enchanters, not his sorcerers, not his magicians, nobody can interpret this dream. And then the cupbearer is like, oh my gosh, I forgot about Joseph. And he tells Pharaoh, you know, I had a dream when I was in the big house. And this Joseph told me, they interpreted the dream for me, and it was true, and it came to pass, and here I am, and I totally forgot about him. And so Pharaoh calls for him. Of course, Joseph comes and interprets the dream, and his dream was that there would be 7 years of fruitfulness, of plenty, and then there was going to be 7 years of famine. And Joseph's like, you got to prepare. In those 7 years of fruitfulness, you got to build storehouses, and you got to set people over, and you got to start collecting grain, and because the 7 years of famine is going to come, and that'll provide for you in the 7 years of famine. So Pharaoh says, well, I need to put somebody over that. And the whole time Joseph is giving honor to God. He even told Pharaoh, he's like, God's the one who interprets dreams. God's the one who did this. And so Pharaoh says, I need somebody who God is with, right? And so he chooses Joseph from prison to be now second only under Pharaoh over all of Egypt. Seems like maybe his dreams are coming true, right? But we all know, delight yourself in the Lord. He'll give you the desires of a heart. We know that guy who has all the riches and is unfulfilled, right? We know the guy who has all the money and he just needs more money, right? Or he has all the fame and now doesn't, like I just watched Michael Jordan's Last Dance. And Michael Jordan says this, he says, if I had to do all over again, I wouldn't want to be a role model. I just want to play basketball, right? The pressures of fame, like most people don't, we look at the rich and famous and a lot of them, their lives are a wreck and they can't handle it. Right? So we see that. And so we know, here's Joseph. Now he has the riches. Now he has the fame. He has the fortune. And yet he's still somewhat unfulfilled. That wasn't the dream that God had given him. This isn't the end of the story. And yet here he is and his family is not there. And so the 7 years of plenty come and he is over all of it and he's doing a great job and they're storing up grain and the 7 years of famine come. That famine and drought was so bad it reaches to Canaan. It reaches his family, his brothers and his father, Israel. And so they send the brothers to come and get grain, buy some food so they can live and not die. And long story short, they end up coming a second time and on the second journey, he reveals himself to him. So let's pick it up there in Genesis 45. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve you for a remnant on the earth, and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh, and a lord of all his house, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. See, Joseph still has this heart that is honoring to God, and even through everything, being thrown in the pit, being sold into slavery, being a slave that is thrown into prison and being betrayed and forgotten, he's still this hopeful optimistic that says, it wasn't you. This was God. This was God's plan. This was God ordering the steps. This was God setting this up so that we could be saved. Not only you, but look at all these people that are saved because of God's plan. Right? We see him later, the Israel, Jacob, the father, dies. And the brothers are still worried that Joseph is going to, now that the dad's gone, he's going to take us out, right? He's not going to treat us well. And so they come to him and he says to him again, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. It sounds a lot like what Paul wrote in Romans 8:28, right? That God is working all things together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. It sounds a lot like we can delight ourselves in the Lord and he will give us the desires of our heart, but it rarely, never does it look like what we would plan. But it's always better. It's always for our good, right? It always saves more people, right? In Joseph's case, it fed and saved an entire nation and Joseph's family. Jesus himself would question in a way, not be okay with the Father's plan. He finds himself in the Garden of Gethsemane and he is stressed to the point of sweating drops of blood. And he says, listen, if there can be another way, right? The words that he uses, if I don't have to drink this cup, but what he's saying is if there's another way, because this is the night that he was going to be betrayed and he knew he was going to the cross to die. And he's like, if there can be another way, but God, Father, not my plan, not my steps, not my will, but yours be done. Because Jesus had a delight. This is what's great about God. He wants our relationship with him to be a delight. Delight yourselves in the Lord. He wants our this Christian walk to be this joyful, exuberant, fulfilling relationship. Delight yourselves in the Lord. And he will give you the desires of your heart. But it's funny because he delights in us. The Bible says over and over again that he delights in us. And Jesus, it would be said of him that for the joy, in Hebrews 12, for the joy that was set before him, right? For the delight that was set before him, you and I, the chance to have a relationship with us for all of eternity, that joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame. How good is God that he would delight in us and he would say, listen, I want you to delight in me as much as I'm delighting in you, and we're going to delight in each other, and you delight in me, and I will give you the desires of your heart. Because Jesus said, even himself, that for the joy that was set before me, he endured the cross. He went through laying his life down so that he could have the desire of his heart, which is you and me. You might have found yourself deceived, forgotten, in your own pit, right? A prisoner. Feeling like you failed. Feeling like these steps, this journey that you're on, doesn't make sense. Delight yourself in the Lord. And he's going to establish your steps. They're not going to be your steps. They're going to be his steps. And along the way, if you allow him, if you will delight yourself in the Lord, no matter what pit you're in, no matter what prison you're in, no matter whether you're feeling forgotten or deceived or rejected, he'll meet you there. And not only will he meet you there, you will thrive there. His favor will be upon you. He is for you. His delight is you. His joy that made him follow through and say, God, not your will, or not my will, but yours be done, was you. That he would go to the cross because of you. Let's pray. God, we thank you. God, we thank you that you delight in us. God, that you love us. God, and that you are wise enough to establish our steps, to order our steps. Lord, God, that as we delight in you, you don't give us, Lord, that opportunity to make our own plan and make those own steps of our own. But God, you order our steps and you work all things together for good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. God, may we delight in you even in times of being in the pit. May we delight in you even in times of feeling rejected, deceived. God, may we set our hearts to fully delight in a God who delights in us. God, we love you and we invite you to order our steps. In Jesus' name, amen.
Time after time, you've been faithful all my life.
us. He's the one who gives the goodness. He's the one who sends the love. It doesn't matter where we are. It doesn't matter what's going on. He is good to us. It sounds crazy to think that when everything's down here, he's up here just giving goodness. All you have to do is just lift your hands, baby. Lift your eyes. Lift your voice and accept the goodness that God is giving you today. It's a place of love that he wants you to be in this world. I want to say
up some praise. God, we thank you. God, you are good. God, you are good because you're good, because you're good. Psalm 121 says, I lift my eyes to the hill. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade and your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forward and forevermore. See, the promise that we have in Scripture is not that all of your problems and all your troubles just poof, go away when you come into a relationship with God, into a relationship with Jesus. But the promise is that even though you find yourself in the pit, even though you find yourself, Psalm 23 says the valley, you don't have to fear evil because he's right there with you, right? Even though you're in Joseph's case, he's sold into slavery and things aren't going the way his dreams said they would. And God, these are not my plans. The promise of Scripture is that he's working. That he's working on your behalf, even when you think he's not. Even when you're like, God, where are you? Turn and you'll find him. That's that delight yourself in the Lord. Delight yourself in the Lord. Proverbs 3:5-6, all through Scripture. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Right? Lean not. Don't lean on your own understanding. But in all your ways, acknowledge him. And he will make your path straight. He will direct your path. We want to trust in the one who is there, right? Even though the songs we sang today, my goodness, even though we walk through that, we find ourselves in a fire, even though we find ourselves in a flood, the promise of Scripture is that we're going to have times of fire and we're going to have times of flood, but even though we walk through the fire, we won't be burned. Even though we find ourselves in the flood, the water, the waves, they won't overtake us. That's the promise. When you find yourself in the pit, look for him and he's there. When you find yourself in the fire, he's there. Look for him. He's working. He's working. He's working. You might today find that you feel like you're in a pit. You feel like you are in that time, that season. Well, we want to be here to pray with you at the close of service. And so we're going to be up here and we want to pray with anybody if you have any needs. Or if today you want to make today that day of salvation where you're choosing to trust in the Lord with all your heart. You're like, I'm tired of leaning on my own understanding. I'm tired of doing things my way, but God, I want to trust you. Jesus, I want to begin my relationship with you. We want to be here to celebrate with you and pray with you about that decision, the best decision of your life you're making today. But for the rest of you, will you just raise your hands? I just speak a blessing over you. May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, thank you for being here today. You are dismissed in Jesus' name.